library every single Thursday, except for the first and last Thursday of the quarter, because we see it as an extension of our charge for the freedom of information and open exchange of ideas. Whether or not you approve every single thing that you find in the books on our shelves, read in our databases, or here in this room today, we want everyone to have access to a wide range of viewpoints and perspectives so that we all learn and grow from each other. So, if you're interested in learning more about this topic, we have a number of books that are available for checkout. You just take it up to the circulation desk, check it out, and take it home for 2 weeks. At the end of this, I'll ask you to fill out a brief survey letting us know what you liked, how you did, and what you'd like to see in the future, so we're going to continue to make this a relevant series. Next week, we actually won't be having a COSI because it is the Unity Fair, so hopefully everyone will be able to go to that if you're not in class during that time. But today, please join me in welcoming our two presenters today, Veronica Barrera-Cole and Dr. Felipe Lagos, as they talk about losing our public schools, lessons from the student revolution in Chile. Please join me in welcoming them.
Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for coming. We're hoping we have a hell of a lot to give you. And so I wanted to introduce myself a little bit and then have Felipe introduce himself. I'm really, really tremendously glad to have Felipe here. He's an expert. And so I'm going to step back a little bit and allow him to do most of the heavy lifting. Welcome. Seattle Central, that's what we do. We invite you and then we make you work. I'm faculty in the humanities department. I teach all the courses in the variety of courses, introduction to LGBTQ, the film courses, intercultural communications, and I'm also originally from Chile. And I was there in Chile at the kind of the spark of the revolution, despite the fact that the organizing had been going on for a number of years. So I got to witness a fair amount. I also had a teenage daughter at the time who was very involved in the movement, and I got a chance to interview a lot of the kind of leaders at the time. And so so it's been a sort of a side note to some of the research that I've been doing in Chile. I mostly research human rights and memory workers, but at the sideline, that was happening, that revolution was happening, so I was witnessing it and being tremendously excited about it. In the context of the United States today, I'm starting to see some real similarities around what happened to us during the coup and after, in the 17 years of the dictatorship, and how public education took a privatization course, and I'm watching that happen more and more in the United States, not just with Betsy DeVos, but certainly before then, and with the Leave No Child Behind Act in 2002, really cemented that process that we are now seeing. And so I felt like it was time to sort of learn from the student movement in Chile, because they've been able to make tremendous cultural, political, and economic change in a way that we can really help to found our own movements around saving our public education. So that's me. I'm gonna hand it over to Felipe and have you introduce yourself a little bit. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Veronica. Well, first, I want to very thank Veronica and the Seattle Central for having me here, for allowing me to talk about this movement, which I was part of during the 2011. I was in my way to go to meet my doctorate in London. So the movement found me without any job, without any occupation, so without time to, to get involved, to work in it, so on and so on. So Veronica asked me for a brief summary of the context and the movement itself, in order to think and to dialogue, about the similarities and the possibility of translating some of these experiences and forms of fighting for particular grievance, in order to translate it to here, to the United States, and especially in this conjuncture of danger of privatization. So I made a brief, but not so brief, presentation. I recommend that kind of 50 minutes, but I think there are a lot of YouTube videos, so we can link those or some of them. So first, in Chile, like in certain moments in the US as well, the student movement has been an historical actor. I would say this started with the presence it has today. It started during the 60s, when the higher education in particular was massified, you know, was made a large scale service. That was, on the one hand, probably because of the pressure of the secondary education, you know, to gain places in the higher education, and worldwide, it was a massification of higher education in the US as well, and that is part of the reasons why worldwide as well, the student rose up and started to demand particular things for education in particular. And during the 80s, you know, in Chile there was a coup d'etat in 1963, a long dictatorship during the 70s and 80s. And during the 80s, because the 70s was the most repressive part of the dictatorship, during the 80s, the student union were a crucial location for the reconstruction of the resistance in Chile. So they were at the vanguard of public demonstration, you know, street demonstrations, occupation of buildings, etc. Some of the former student leaders were during the 90s, you know, part of the government, the transitional government of the Concertación, who was the bloc who replaced Pinochet. However, during the 80s, there was a deep restructuration and privatization of the public education in general and of universities in particular. The restructuration took two main forms. First, the allowance, the emergence of, and they opened the field for private institutions, private universities, and other higher education institutions to compete in the same way that public universities have done during the previous period. And on the other, they you know, restricted the resources for public education, so this institution had to go to the market as any other institution and look for, you know, payers, clients, who the students were starting to be treated like, you know, clients. That's 2011 figure or character in the frontispiece of the main public university in Chile, that's Pinochet, you know, and this is a picture who shows how present was Pinochet in the 2011 demonstrations. This is perhaps the big picture. By 2011, the Chilean higher educational system was the most expensive of the world in proportion to the national GDP. Today it remains the second among all OECD countries. On the one hand, in the mandatory primary and secondary education, the participation of families, that is the private participation in the system, is about 40%, and in higher education it raises the 84%. That's very, very big, you know, for a country like Chile, which is a country that, on the one hand, has a GDP of about 20,000 $1,000 per year, but that Chile has also one of the more higher Gini index. The Gini is an index to measure inequality inside, you know, within the country. And Chile is one of the five countries in the world with the most higher Gini. So, you know, Gini, I mean. So the GDP, the general GDP is just an average. So more than half of the families can afford these rates of you know, in the public university, the fees today are kind of $3,500 a year, when the minimum income is kind of $300 per month. So yeah, so. If you want to go to the university, you have to spend all of your money in that, or to get debts with the private banks, which we are going to return.
So let me interject there to do a little bit of U.S. Context. So perfect. So Elementary and Secondary Education Act of 1965 is one of the most progressive acts in education here in the United States. That really provided public education for most students. It came out of the civil rights movement and out of huge movements, and so it was a fairly progressive act. The act was then, of course, allowed for the building of the infrastructure of public education in the United States. It started schools all over the city. It included starting things like community colleges. So the one that you're sitting in right now was part of that process, that opening up of education. And that begins to end, and begins to end in a very clear way in the state in 2002 when the Leave No Child Behind Act gets passed, which includes now a certain kind of language to the conversation, very much like the 80s in Chile. Includes conceptions like accountability. Accountability becomes part of the discourse in a way that hadn't been before. So you are, in other words, accountability, and that immediately adds sort of language, market language, to our public education. Performance funding. So it adds the idea of that schools have to perform. Performing, of course, comes at the through the measures of high-stakes testing, right? So now you get tests, and kids must pass that standardization of education. And then, of course, the big conversation that happens, and this is something that grounds the Chilean experience, is choice. You get to choose where you go, right? And of course, most of us know that choice is mediated by a whole bunch of economic factors that, of course, don't take into account things like working class families. And so we're watching a very similar kind of process that happened here in the 80s that began for us in 2002 and has been taking much, much more form. So as we move forward, you'll see sort of the kind of links between them.
I would say, and I was a witness of this process, you know, I was in the university at this time during the late 90s and early 2000s. Albeit, on the one hand, we have many features inherited from the authoritarian regime of the early 19th. Many of us, you know, were born in that period. The student movement was sort of enclosed into their own demands and their own grievances during the 90s. They started to, create new forms of resistance. That's a picture of, you know, some protest we had, and we decided to color the cops, you know, instead of throwing Molotov. Paintings pictures, and you have this kind of aesthetic intervention in the streets. That was just one
It's a little bit like the queering of cops, because they became rainbowed.
Yeah. And that's fantastic when we can, you know, target and point to the cars, to the big cars where the cops throw water with a lot of chemicals to the demonstrators. And so you can see when that car leaves the scene, and it's a rainbow. And in 2006, there was an antecedent for the 2011 movement, which was known as the Penguin Movement, or the Pinguinazo. We call the primary and secondary students penguins because of they have to use uniform, you know? You can see them a bit there, and so they look like penguins. So they demonstrate nationally in a very articulated way against the LOCE, which was the Pinochet Educational Act. You know, in Chile, the last days of the dictatorship, Pinochet and his friends passed a lot of bills, quick bills, in order to trap, really, you know, some key sectors of Chile. And one of these was the LOCE, which was passed one day before the change of the president. You know. Just one example of this, but the student rises against this bill and the quality of the secondary education in general, you know. Despite the massive popularity of the mobilization, which included teachers and university union who supported the student movement, the secondary movement, the authorities did nothing but take the old LOCE and make it up into a LEGE, which is more the same. This is a very characteristic picture because a student threw, you know, water in the face of the Secretary of Education, that's the Secretary of Education, in a public meeting, you know. That was very condemned by the media and very celebrated by the supporters of the movement. But afterwards, you know, they make an arrangement, they make another law, another act, they pass it, and nothing changed at that moment. And furthermore, a more perverse mechanism was imposed, which was the CAE, which is very, very similar to which Veronica was explaining is happening here. You know, according to performance, a student has a voucher, you know, which is a loan paid by the state, but given by a private bank. You know, you get indebted with that bank sometimes for the rest of your life, because it depends how much, how long it takes you to end the college, your performance, the fees that the college, in Chile, the college and the careers have difference in fees. So it depends on a lot of circumstances, but the main fact is the bank is supported by, you know, public resources in order to make profit from students. That was the mechanism to keep on massifying the education, and that was the main argument of the authorities. We need to secure, you know, every person, no matter what, can go into the higher education, and the no matter how and what is the important part here, because the way they choose was to indebt students, not to support the public sector of the higher education, because they are still dependent on vouchers or on the demand of their service, and finally to make a very good business to banks, because they have secure credit there, you're right over there, you know, you don't have to move to get that clients. Well, that's one of the more symbolic banners of the 2011. 5 years dealing, 15 paying. You know, that was one of the slogans of the period of the 2011, and that is a consequence of the guys, which was passed in 2006, just right after the penguin movement. And nonetheless, the uprising demonstrated the vitality and connection of the young generation, and this is the same generation that 5 years later, in 2011, will face the upcoming of a right-wing government, businessman Sebastián Piñera, who is running for a new period now, who was eager to deepen the commodization of higher education.
He's running again, huh? Mm. So in the same time in the United States, this is a kind of international globalization process. Chile is particularly stark because it happened, all of these kinds of things happened during a dictatorship, so no kind of public discourse around all of these things. But for us, there's been public discourse, but the difference is that we haven't gone out in the streets. In Chile, they have, en masse. So the Penguin Revolution in 2006, schools were shut down, the whole nation really was shut down. The students took over the schools, shut down the schools, closed them with chairs and desks and stuff, and would not let. Many of the schools were closed up to 30 days. So you know, the president had to come on TV and go, "Kids, could you guys?" I mean, that's you know. So there's a little bit of difference in terms of how it's happened for us in the United States. So one of the things that the Leave No Child Behind performance funding happens is, so you start beginning to starve the state. So, and that's a political neoliberal strategy where you starve the state. In other words, you provide less and less funding, you make funding linked to other things like performance, like high stakes testing. And so you begin to take money away from schools. Schools, of course, begin to fail because they're underfunded, and then it just goes into a nice little, right? And then you introduce things like vouchers and charter schools, which of course both begin to privatize education very much, like in Chile. In the United States, currently we are living a higher education market. Right now we have $1.3 trillion in debt. Students are in debt that much. So the debt crisis, in terms of how many of you in the room are currently have student loans? Oh, all the adults. All the people that graduated already, I'm like, oh yeah. So the student loan crisis is in the United States is about ready to pop. So in many ways, this kind of similar process, and of course, Piñera was elected, right-wing government, right, very market-driven. Sounds similar to you in terms of the Trump administration and their particular project. Very much the same. The difference is the Chilean students spoke out. Right, they did not stay passive. They spoke out, and they spoke out in mass.
Yeah, we are going to start that part now. introducing 5 minutes.
I remember you, Amanda. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Sheikh.
Two leaders of the Chilean student movement are in the United States this week, where they will be awarded the 2012 Letelier Moffitt Human Rights Award. The prize.
No, it's just a screen issue.
You might have to exit the PowerPoint presentation and then go to the YouTube.
ICE is named for the Chilean diplomat. Orlando Letelier and his colleague Ronnie Carpen Moffat, who were.
Yeah. can usually handle it, figure it out. Maybe you should drag it over. We can do it. So, let me say it while we're. We
can't use all our time. Murdered in Washington by agents of the US-backed Chilean dictator Carmen Moffat. Who were murdered in Washington by agents of the US-backed Chilean dictator General Augusto Pinochet in September 1976. Over the past year, the Chilean Students' Movement has led some of the largest protests in Chile since the days of opposition marches to Pinochet a generation ago. The movement has rallied hundreds of thousands into the streets of Santiago and other major cities to demand greater access to affordable university education, as well as deeper structural changes in Chile. The country has the highest per capita income in the region, but also one of the most unequal distributions of wealth.
Joining us are Noam Titelman, the current president of the Catholic University Student Federation. He's one of the main leaders of the Chilean student protest, and he's a student in commercial engineering and Spanish literature at the Catholic University of Chile in Santiago. We are also joined by Camila Vallejo, Vice President of the University of Chile Student Federation from late 2010 through 2011. She was president of the organization and has been a main spokesperson for the National Student Federation, the Confederation of Chilean Students. Camila Vallejo is also a member of the Central Committee of the Chilean Communist Youth and a geography student at the University of Chile in Santiago. Her interpreter is Marcial Godoy. And we welcome you all to Democracy Now. Noam, let's begin with you. Talk about the significance of the movement and what is taking place now in Chile. In the United States, it is hard enough to get protests covered in the United States, let alone in Chile, no matter how significant they are.
Yes, I think the first thing to understand is that we have a very special educational system, which was imposed during the 1980s, during the Pinochet dictatorship. Which has one basic principle, and it's that the market always works. And we found out that obviously it's not that way, always. And what we've seen is that, for example, while our public education is dying, we have only 36% of students going to public schools. Here in the States, it's almost 90%. It's really a very special example of how privatized state become. And all of this started accumulating a lot of problems, a lot of inequalities, and this exploded many occasions during the last decades. But during the 2011, it had a special massification of this issue, and we saw almost all of schools and universities of the country paralyzed for almost 6 months, over a million people in the streets. And we even saw some students willingly losing their academic year, many thousands of them. And all of this is obviously because something is not working with this extremely privatized educational system.
Camila Vallejo, can you talk about how it is that the movement was able to mobilize such large numbers of people?
¿Cómo fue que el movimiento fue capaz de movilizar el número tan grande de personas?
Bueno, primero creo importante señalar a propósito del premio que estamos recibiendo por parte de la Fundación Letelier Maffitt, que es muy simbólico dado que Orlando Letelier fue una de las primeras personas que advirtió las consecuencias que iba a tener la implementación del modelo neoliberal en Chile por medio de la dictadura militar.
First, I want to remark in the light of the Letelier Maffitt Prize that we're receiving that Orlando Letelier was one of the first to warn about what would come with the implementation of neoliberal policies during the dictatorship.
Él señalaba que por medio de la fuerza en Chile no solamente se iba a instaurar una economía de libre mercado, sino que una sociedad de libre mercado. Y que este iba a tocar incluso lo que antes era considerado derechos básicos como la salud, la educación o el seguro social.
He warned that through violence in Chile there would not only be a sort of a market society put in place, but actually that all many things that were previously considered basic rights would be turned into a neoliberal good.
Renato Letelier was the former Chilean ambassador to the United States who was blown up in a car bomb on Embassy Row in Washington, D.C. in 1976.
Right.
Y que eso iba a terminar haciendo que las familias no solamente tuvieran que pagar por los servicios básicos, sino que incluso por los derechos, a tal punto que ante la desigualdad que existe en Chile iban a tener que endeudarse para acceder a eso. Eso ha terminado en un profundo malestar de la sociedad que desembocó esta movilización a través de la educación.
And that these circumstances would end in the privatization of basic rights and of basic goods, and that families would have to become indebted to procure these basic things, and that's what led really in Chile to these massive protests.
Camila Vallejo and Noam Tiedemann, we have to end it there, but we'll continue in a post-show discussion, post online at democracynow.org. That does it for our broadcast. If you'd like a copy of the show, you can go to our website, democracynow.org.
You know, just to show you how present was the memories of the dictatorship and the process of neoliberalization
With the battle against the draft won and the creation of an all-volunteer force a reality, Milton continues to press home his argument for minimum government. Strategies, tactics, and Logan. I would say one of the main achievements of the 2011 Chilean student movement was the national articulation again. Just like the 2006, in the 2011, there was a national articulation in the context of a deeply segregated educational system, which means two things for me. On the one hand, the union and the articulation between secondary and higher education students, which not always happens because they have very different tactics, very different motivations. Secondary are seen usually as the non-privileged part of the, especially the public secondary education, while the university are kind of the privileged. But they did not differ in this moment. They joined forces and they struggled together. On the other hand, the integration of public and private universities, which is, you know, in a segregated system, it is quite difficult to get, and it was a massive articulation between kind of first and second class higher education institution, which is how the market works in Chile. When you don't have means to secure the quality of the education imparted in some schools, in some college, you know. So the market immediately start making difference between first class and second class institutions, first class and second class diploma. So that generates a competition between students, like happens in the work in the labor market, etc. In the among the students, it always happens. It also happens, and this was kind of prevented in this moment by transversal articulation. As a whole, public and private school and first and second class higher education institution merged into a movement headed by the CONFED. The CONFED is the national articulation of public institutions in the higher education. It's the Confederación de Estudiantes de Chile, the Confederation of Chilean Students. And in that period, Camila Vallejo was the president of the Federación de Estudiantes de la Universidad de Chile, which is the main university in Chile. and the spokeswoman of the conference. The main slogan of the movement was free, public, and quality education. Yeah. That's a fantastic banner because in that year it was the American Soccer Cup in Argentina. So that that flag traveled in different stadiums in Argentina. You know, that was televised in Chile, so people in Chile watching football or watching soccer could see demonstration across the frontiers. That was one of the last demonstrations in Chile when that flag returned to home. As a slogan, the claim for free public and quality education takes several layers of meaning. First, free, not restricted by income criteria. And also, there was a call for a restructuration of the national admission system, which includes a universal test, which is very, like here, you know, the GRE is quite segregated. It's a segregation test, which
we call them high stakes testing, like the SATs and the GREs.
That's it. So the PSU in Chile is a similar form of universal entrance to the university, mostly for the public education. So that generates that contributes to the segregation of the system. Public, because there was a direct and stronger claim for funding, for public funding to public education, for public institutions, you know, to some institutions, the state-owned institutions, which would get them rid of market competition for their students. Mm-hmm. And quality, because while the market has signified a massive access to higher education, the figures are at the end of Allende's regime, the government was kind of 50,000 people. At the end of the 2000s, there was kind of 500,000 people, kind of a massive increment.
Can you hold on to that for us?
Yeah.
Okay, so in the United States, one of the things, of course, is, you know, the idea of a free education, like in other words, having, and that's one of the things that came up in the Obama administration about second year, having a public education. And public for us is this conception of free. That's when we term it public, it means that it's paid for by specific processes that allow access to all, not just a few, but all. Demands from students, right? So, I mean, that's the thing I think we need to think about and think through, is this idea that we allow for the government to make these decisions for us, when in Chile, the students were like, this is about us, and we're gonna take charge of it, and we're gonna do it. And we're gonna demand these things that we know that we're in crisis here in the United States, right? So we don't have free education. We don't have public education. We don't have quality. All of this is the same things. And this has been a fairly long process. For most of you who went to, how many of you went to public school? How many of you went? So, and it should be, if you're a student here, you should raise your hand. right? So, public education is one of the things that in the United States, anytime there's a poll for public education, families come out in support of public education at huge numbers. 93% of the people polled who are currently in families, who are currently in public education, say their public education provides a really good education for their kids. So there's not a lack of kind of happiness about it. And one of the things that they say in the same kinds of polls is that they want better funding. That their primary issue is better funding. Better funding for things like nurses, or because only certain schools have nurses, all other schools have. So for many of you, and I know that you were in that process, Joel, in the process of looking for schools for our children, right? And it is staggering that we have to look for, like, what, because public schools are so different So if your kid is at a school in Bellevue versus a kid who is in school in the South End, you're going to see distinct differences in the schools. But we as parents, we as taxpayers, we don't demand these kinds of things. And in Chile, the thing that's most important and the thing that most that's most staggering is how the students found themselves changing their own education and demanding for these things, seeing clearly politicizing themselves and politicizing the discourse around public schools. Right now, many people look at DeVos, right, Betsy DeVos, and go, but there is no mass movement to really demand a particular thing. And that I think that's the basic lesson of the United States is how, and I think that Felipe can speak really clearly about how these students saw themselves impacted by it and were able to sort of move towards collectivity. And part of it, of course, is that having been there during the dictatorship, when you're facing resistance to a dictator, right, you learn particular kinds of skills because your life is on the line. Right, and so the kind of lessons that were brought for that we learned during those 17 years of resistance towards a dictatorship, who was murdering people and torturing people and exiling people, and was repressing the media and all of this totalitarian strategies, we learned very clearly that we needed to come together to do that. And so that those lessons are really played out in the ways that education has. And I think you're going to show some of the strategies that folks
yeah.
Used.
Yeah.
That's the note I want.
On top of Bernard's comments, I would say it's not casual, it's not a matter of choice. The leaders of the student movement were left-wing kind of person, from the Communist Party, from other groups, minor groups in the universities and outside, who were the ones who were, you know, building this social and cultural networks in a context in which in Chile, you know, the social tissue was totally destroyed by the dictatorship by means of assassinations, torture, terror, etc. So they were very politically oriented, that is, some of them from political parties, other from colleges and groups, minor groups. And they were very attacked by the mainstream media, of course, you know. They were persons who were spoken for a minority, persons who were terrorists, persons who didn't want to talk, to argue, you know, in a civilized way, etc. But however, they achieved a very important public support in Chile. By May 21 is the day of the presidential account to the nation. So there's always
State of the Union. Our State of the Union.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what
I'm talking about. Yeah. So there's always a massive demonstration in the streets. But this year, the student demonstrations were at normal levels at that day to, 2,000 attendants. But 1 month later, 100,000 persons met in Santiago and many other miles in other cities that are, you know, figures which are important in relation to the total population of the country, which is 16 million now. So, as the video said, this was the first largest massive demonstration since the dictatorship, since the 1988, which was the most massive demonstration of that period. And this was a turning point. After the former massive demonstration, there was another one, which was, you know, totally targeted by the media about the failure that was once and never again, you know, so many people in the street. And this faced the weather inclemency, but the student could, you know, they found the way to demonstrate even when it was raining that day, like here.
It's not Seattle rain, this is like pouring rain.
I remember, you know, rain like hours and hours and hours, and still 100,000 people were in the streets that day, the umbrellas, right? That started to change the approach of the student to the mobilization. They started to create more funny, you know, more appealing ways to convey the demands, the grievance to the public opinion. And I want to show, well, they combined official or formal interventions led by the Confesh in the parliament, in the secretary office, in the mass press, and some mainstream think tank, and this street manifestation. I want to show you, this is the Thriller for Education. And I want to show you the...
We probably won't have time for it, but...
Sorry?
Yeah. Oh, at least in the movie. How many people showed up for this one? Was it like... So one of the things I wanted to end with, wanted to thank Felipe so much for his incredible knowledge around it, but also one of the things that's important to understand is that through these mass demonstrations of 100,000 people, and I know that in Seattle, you know, we had the Women's March, it was one of the largest that we've ever seen in Seattle, and so that was reoccurring in Chile fairly often. And people have a culture of going out into the streets. So why go out into the streets? There's a couple of reasons, but one of the primary reasons is because when you go out into the streets, you are one, constructing knowledge for the, you're constructing knowledge for members of the movement. In other words, the movement is sort of understanding the kinds of, you know, educating each other about what's happening, but also you're constructing knowledge about some of the issues for the outer kind of public, right? You're, in many ways, you are constructing a public. And those publics are crucial in the ways in which social change happens. So mass demonstrations are one of the strategies used by the movement, but there were a number of them. But so one of the things that you can do is I would suggest you do some looking up at in Chile in the student revolution, and there's lots of really great examples about all the multiple things that they did and how they really ended up changing the country. And the lesson, of course, is that we can also, and not only can we, we're going to have to. I would put that call to action for us as we watch Betsy DeVos and her friends, as you call the Pinochet people, her friends, really trying to create a market out of our educational system. And we need to be able to galvanize in order to combat that. And Chile is a great example, lots of strategies, lots of slogans, lots of tactics, and they have been fundamentally transformative. And so changing the landscape of the way in which the politics gets done in Chile. So I think that we can do that, and we just need to look around to see what lessons there are so that we are constantly understanding that social movements are crucial and are crucial right now in our current climate. Thank you so much, Ade. It's very good to see you.
Between 1 and 2:30, there's going to be a film showing in BE4106, and there's a free screening of Resistencia, right, which is documenting last year's public school occupation in Brazil. So if you want to go to that, you can grab a flyer that's up here. I recognize that folks need to go to class or go to lunch or do whatever you need to do. So if you have questions, you're welcome to stay and ask the presenters, and if not, you're dismissed. Free, I will accept your service.
You can ask to
here.
You? for the presentation if you want to repeat it.
Also, if it's okay with you, I can post it on the library's website.
That's
so anyone who wants to access this can do that. Right. Again, join me in thanking our presenters.
Thank you.